She's behind you. The heel is broken off her left shoe, and she drags it across the ground with every step. A sharp contrast to the steady click of her still intact pump. "Help me," she whispers. It's an urgent anguish plea. "Please, I'm hurt. Help me." Don't turn around. That's when she gets you. Don't run. She still gets you. But this time, she's going to make it hurt. At least, that's the rumor anyway. Every small town has at least one. A local urban legend that everyone knows and swears is true. Because their sister's best friend's cousin's neighbor's grandson knew a fella who actually encountered it. Ours was the limping woman, so named for her aforementioned distinct gait. It was said that she was a teacher at the elementary school some decades before. Young, beautiful, and the victim of a terrible murder. She had been walking home to the house she shared with her parents one night after school. When she realized she was being followed, she sped up and so did her pursuer, until both were running down the dark country lane with only open farmland on either side. Her heel broke and her ankle snapped. She fell and her pursuer became her murderer. It was a slow, torturous affair that left her beaten and covered in stab wounds. And when the killer was done, he just left her to bleed out beside the road. She wasn't found until the next morning. By then, all anyone could do was search for the person responsible. While some believe the man was caught and dealt with not long after, others think he or she is still at large, and the limping woman, as the victim came to be known, won't rest until her killer is caught. I was always skeptical at best of the story. I'd passed the spot where she was supposed to appear 100 times without incident, as did everyone else I knew. If her murderous ghost lived there, I was pretty sure I'd have seen her. I said as much to my friend Steffi when she brought up the fact that a friend of a friend of a friend had met the limping woman during lunch at school one day. It's true. She was out on the old highway a couple of nights ago and saw her. Steffi insisted stubbornly over her sandwiches. If she actually saw her, wouldn't she be dead? I asked. I thought you weren't supposed to turn around. Heard her, whatever, you know what I mean. Sure, I said with a roll of my eyes. It always frustrated Steffi that I didn't share her willingness to believe the unbelievable. So how'd she get away? She said the words, duh. Oh right, the woman's last words. Last words we all somehow know without even having caught the one person who would have heard them. We know them because the real killer was never caught. He told people who told other people. And we all just magically knew to use them to ward off being killed. I finished her. Steffi frowned. She loved all things spooky and supernatural, and had spent a lot of time researching our local legends, especially the limping woman. It's not magic, it just reminds her of her own mother, and she gets distracted by the grief and leaves you alone. Okay, okay, I said, hoping that would be enough to put an end to the topic. It was an argument neither of us would win, and I didn't feel like getting into it again over whether or not a ghost was real. At 15, it was starting to feel silly. Steffi, however, wasn't going to let me off easy. They say she remains because they got the wrong person, and she's angry about it. Like, everyone knew it, but no one cared because they wanted to blame someone. Don't you feel at least a bit bad for her? She's still waiting for justice after all this time. Steffi. She only goes after people who don't believe her, you know. I didn't like the way Steffi said that. Like she had an idea of forming that I wouldn't approve of, and I shook my head. Whatever it is, no. We could go out there, out to the spot she haunts. No, don't be dumb, I said. You don't believe anyway, so what's the big deal? I've walked past there, okay, and nothing ever happened. Have you gone after dark? Steffi had started to smile. No, but so what? That's when she's active. Going in the day doesn't count. This is dumb, I said again. We'll go tonight. Every argument I had was met with questions of whether I was too afraid and Steffi mocking me for being chicken. She kept it up for the rest of lunch, through our shared science class, and then passed me notes in the halls between classes after that. By the time the final bell rang, she had worn me down. But not because I believe she's there. I made sure she knew. I'm just going, so shut you up. The sun set after 5 that evening. At 7, we met up on our bikes in front of our neighborhood. Her parents thought she was doing a project at mine. Mine thought I was at hers. And we had 2 hours to ride out to the farm where the limping woman was said to haunt and get back before they started. And street lamps until darkness swallowed us up. With only moonlight to guide us, we wove our way across town and passed into the outskirts, where the insects were louder, the stars were brighter, and the safety that came from feeling like you were surrounded by other people fell away. It was hard not to feel entirely exposed out on the old road, where flat fields rolled off into the distance on either side. There was an occasional barn, a farmhouse set a ways off down long, dusty drives, but otherwise, it was really just our bikes and the night. Up ahead, Steffi said from behind me, see the cross? That's the marker for her. We skid to a stop, a few rods away from it, exchanged a glance, almost lost in the shadows. Scared? She asked, breathless with excitement. No, I said. It was an honest enough answer. I was nervous, sure, but who wouldn't be? You're outside after dark. Remember, if you turn around, she gets you. If you try and run, she makes it worse. Just stand still when she's close by and say the words. Steffi spoke so seriously that I had to stifle a giggle. It was ridiculous. I kept trying to tell that to all the butterflies stirring in my stomach. But it didn't do much good. We climbed off our bikes and set them on their kickstand. Groped around my hand and entwined her fingers with mine. She was shaking. Ready? Let's just get it over with, I replied. We walked up to where the cross was placed and paused. Steffi squeezed my hand and took it in a slow, shuddering breath. Her fear was starting to have an effect on me. Quickening my heartbeat, but I squared my shoulders, clenched my jaw, and took a step forward. We crept along the roadside, careful to keep our eyes pointed straight ahead. Steffi kept reminding me in a trembling whisper that looking anywhere else could lead to trouble. A minute or two passed. It couldn't have been much longer despite feeling like it, and nothing seemed to happen. My fear began to ebb, replaced by an admittedly relieved giddiness that I had been right, and I almost turned to Steffi to say I told you so. And then I realized how quiet it was. All the insects that had been singing loudly when we arrived had gone silent. There were no distant calls from nightbirds, no breeze passing over us, nothing. Just the sound of our own breathing. To my surprise, Steffi died. Disappointed, I wondered if she realized how quiet everything had become. How could she not feel the claustrophobic? stuff we wear in the dark and the silence. I wanted to ask her, but the question was like a knot in my throat that I couldn't untangle. Behind us, grass rustled, followed by the crunch of loose gravel underfoot, like someone was pulling themselves slowly out of the field and onto the road. Drag, click, drag, click. Every hair on my body stood up at once. Rena. I hadn't realized that my grip on Steffi's hand had tightened so much. I could feel her eyes on me, but couldn't bring myself to look at her. From somewhere over my shoulder, a woman started to sob. Help me, she cried plaintively. Rena, Steffi said again. She's coming, I managed to whisper. Instead of being scared, Steffi snorted. Real funny, I get it, okay. The limping woman is just made up. I'm convinced now, you don't have to rub it in. Drag, click, drag, click. The unmistakable sound of someone inching towards us slowly. Crying out with each step. Please, she begged. I'm hurt, and he's still out there. Steffi, I hissed, tears burning in my eyes. She's coming. Steffi was jerking on my arm and saying something to me over and over again, but I could barely hear her over the limping woman's cries. The smell was getting so strong, making my stomach pitch and heave until I thought I'd be sick. I leaned heavily on Steffi, and she pulled me in close so that her lips were beside my ear. Through the veil of panic and nausea, I heard her scream, "Say the words!" So close behind us now that I could feel the chill radiating off her. The words, I thought. I had to say the words. It just reminds me of her own mother, and she gets distracted by her grief and leaves you alone. I heard Steffi's voice from the previous day echo in my head. Her mother, the words remind her of her mother, the limping woman's last words. Please, bile rose in the back of my throat. My mother's waiting.